Riemann surfaces. This would be from a physics and mathematics point of view. Some elementary questions in mathematics are, if you integrate a polar angle, you get 2 pi, and the square root of 1 is equal to 1. Well, yes, you say. Or is it minus 1? Because if you square minus 1, you get plus 1. Similarly, if you went just past 2 pi in the integral over the polar angle, you would get back to 0, so then you get 0. We usually identify 0 and 2 pi. But how does this make sense if you keep going past 2 pi? Shouldn't we get to 4 pi and so on? Of course, we know that these are not really problems, but they usually make us think, and they lead to interesting questions that we can address in the context of Riemann surfaces. One nice book is by Miranda. That is much deeper than what I will do here. Here we'll do some very simple basic statements. So a sphere is a Riemann surface. As we will see, it needs to have some complex structure to it. For example, what about the wobbly torus? If you deform the torus, is this a Riemann surface? Well, let's think about this example. Here's an explicit embedding of a torus in 3-space. I've drawn here the Gauss curvature in color. Outside here, these points are a lot like points on a sphere. They're positively curved. The two principal directions of curvature are the same. Whereas here, the two principal directions of curvature are different. That's an invariant statement. So whatever you mean by in and out, you're going to notice that this is negatively curved and this is positively curved. But all that has to do with extrinsic curvature, as defined, for example, in chapter 10 in Conlon's book that I referred to at the beginning. But topologically, a two torus product of two circles, this cycle and this cycle. We could draw a grid where we say, let's identify x is x plus 1 and y is y plus 1. We draw a fundamental region based on some origin, 0, and say that this is the fundamental region of my torus. And all these other parts, that's just going around the cycles of the torus. Now, topologists work with rubber, as people say. The details don't matter so much. But let's say we had a complex structure. So instead of just having two real circles, x and y, let's say this is 1 and this is I. So now we put a complex structure on this. Metrically, we have still not allowed for any different distance here and here or any different angle between this line and this line, for example. So let's allow that. This introduced a complex structure tau that has a real and imaginary part. And the metric can be written like this. This is a flat metric, as it turns out, if you compute the curvature. But this captures the fact that periodicity is non-trivial. Z, a point somewhere here, is identified with the point Z plus integer m plus integer n times tau. For example, z0 is identified with z equals 1 and z equals tau. Then we think about diffeomorphisms or mappings of metrics. And that's the statement here. Even if this is flat, you can't in general map it to something that preserves this periodicity without ruining this kind of structure. Let's be more precise. How could we relabel this and still have the same torus? If we shift tau plus 1, that's a relabeling with m and n. This is nicely described in Polchinski's book that I referred to at the beginning of this video. If you flip 1 over tau and switch the sign, and you rescale z to z prime, then this is also relabeling. So we have two operations that give you the same torus back. The combined action of these generate the modular group. So a and b and c and d are integers, and the determinant ad minus bc is equal to 1, and you identify if you flip the signs of all of them, so this is called PSL2z, the modular group. That means that under this transformation, not all tau are different, and we can restrict to a fundamental region, this gray area that goes up to infinity, or any other fundamental region here in this upper half plane. This is the moduli space of a torus. So this means that these are the inequivalent parameters describing the periodicity structure of a torus. Now let's go to a sphere. Does a sphere have a natural complex structure? Yes, in a different video we discuss stereographic projection, and in fact, the south stereographic projection and the north one are related by simple complex inversion. You can also get a metric structure from this. Just compute differentials of these maps. You'll see the metric structure of the Riemann sphere. More specifically, let's apply a wild transformation. A wild transformation means rescale the metric, now we're just on a surface, with a possibly coordinate-dependent function. Then the square root of the determinant of the metric times the curvature transforms by a shift like this, where omega is this omega here. So from a flat metric, dz, dz bar in complex coordinates, you can get to a metric that looks like this. It's called conformal gauge or mathematics isothermal coordinates. So an interesting question becomes, if you came from some other flat metric w, and you went to some other conformal gauge, how do you relate these two? So an interesting question becomes, if you had another metric like this, with another omega prime, how would you transform between them? Well, this metric, now we go coordinate change here by the usual rules. Now for complex coordinates, we get this. And we see that to get back to a form like this, we need for the cross terms here, this one and that one, to vanish, which means w must be a holomorphic function of z. It should not have any z bar dependence. If that is true, then these two vanish and we just go back to a flat looking thing times some factor in front. The conformal transformation is specified by a holomorphic function, w of z, and a wild transformation that can bring it back to unit metric if you want. So now we can more generally define a complex manifold, in particular a surface. Of course, it has to have even real dimensions if it's going to have any chance to be complex. And what we learn is we should restrict to holomorphic coordinate transformations, and transition functions should be holomorphic. One way to express this, for example, Puchinsky's book, is that a Riemann surface is a manifold, a Riemannian manifold, mod wild transformations. We should think of metrics that are related by wild transformations, in the sense of the previous slide, as being the same. So this is a natural habitat for a theory that is invariant on a conformal transformation, which in physics is called a conformal field theory. So in physics, conformal field theories naturally live on Riemann surfaces. This can be continued to higher dimensions. You can look for a complex structure in general, where this integrable is determined by this tensor, and this is beyond the scope of this video. So the conformal group is infinite dimensional. We saw that there was a holomorphic function. Its series expansion gives an infinite number of parameters, and the generators form a Witt algebra. The Möbius group only has three parameters, if you're complex. You can think of them as a subgroup of the Witt group. And these are the holomorphic differentials corresponding to these parameters. Now, there's an amazing result called the uniformization theorem, which is key in Riemann surface theory, that really there are only three classes of Riemann surfaces. There's the sphere, the torus that we talked about, and other. And we classify them by genus, which gives the number of handles. So sphere has no handle, torus has a handle, and then there are those that have more than one handle. This is not completely unique. We can also put marked points on them. You can reabsorb some of the marked points in transition functions. So this is a very important discussion, that marked points, in some sense, is on the same footing as transition functions. What about those other? Here's the double torus. It's the first thing that might be new to some viewers. So you have the sphere, the torus, and the double torus, and so on. This has order characteristic -2, genus is 2, and this has a metric, so it has the Poincaré metric on the upper half plane. Not to be confused with the moduli space of the single torus, has also has a Poincaré metric, but here we actually have a metric on the space itself. This should be thought of as a space of constant negative curvature, even though, again, we should not be misled by drawing it like this, that the embedding, a naive embedding in three space, will have varying curvature, for example, negative here and positive here, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about something more like the analog of the identification of the plane by lattice. It's also a very interesting discussion of this metric in these physics papers. Now, what can you do with a Riemann surface? One of the key theorems on the Riemann surface is Riemann-Roch. There's a beautiful proof by this that I will have no chance to go through here. Riemann's own proof, I will state a few things about, and I will go through the heat kernel proof and refer to another video for a straight-up one-line physics proof. Riemann's own proof that you can enjoy in this file here, it uses a few facts that I won't go through. It says there are exactly G-independent holomorphic differential forms on a compact Riemann surface of genus G, meaning G handles. For each point P, there's one meromorphic differential with a double polar P and zero residue. And then from there, you try to get something that's like a converse of the residue theorem. There's a beautiful discussion of this on this page. So that was a very broad statement. We still don't really know what the theorem says. So let's do a mathematical physics proof, the heat kernel method. So let's consider some differential operators on a Riemann surface that is possibly curved. The Christoffel symbols, when you have such something so simple that it only has a single independent component, g, z, z bar, if you take gamma z, 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 you just get this. And in fact, in this conformal gauge, you just get that. And then the similar thing for the bar. So this is a very, very simple situation, and this is why these objects are so nice to work with. Your complicated Christoffel symbols in general reduce to something this simple for a single function omega. We have covariant-like derivatives that add or take away indices. If you didn't have only z, you had some z bars, you can always change that by using the metric that converts z and z bar. This n differential operator acts like this, and this acts like that, where n is number of top indices minus the number of bottom indices, sometimes called the helicity of the tensor. We have these two kinds of differential operators. And one interesting thing to think about is how many solutions are there of setting this operator to zero? That's the dimension of the kernel of this operator. And the Riemann-Roch theorem states, amazingly, that this is a very, very simple expression in terms of the genus and n, where this is this order here of this operator. Sometimes this combination is called an index, so this is an index theorem. In Puchinsky's book, this is a problem. He writes these differential operators in slightly different conventions as P. So let's look how you would prove this. You write a heat kernel, which means that this is a what's called a Green's function, which I discussed in another video, for the heat equation. But this heat equation has a Laplacian that has this curved stuff. So what you do is you separate out. Notice that this one here is just cancel this thing here. So what you do is you separate out a simple Laplacian, and then you consider a simplified kernel. This is called Fredholm theory, where this V is not there. And this is very simple to solve. You can solve it explicitly. This is all discussed in Nakahara's book. And then you can compute the actual Kn that you're interested in at coincident points by doing a repeated integral, where you have the simple K, that solves this equation times the V operator times another K. And you expand it for short T, for short time, as we would say in physics. And you can actually do this explicitly, as discussed in Nakahara. And you obtain something simple, and then something depends on n and the Laplacian of the metric function omega for short times. And then we do a similar thing for the other differential operator. You get a similar looking expression, and you notice that this Laplacian of omega is actually essentially the curvature, because the only thing we had in the metric was omega, so it should better determine the curvature, and in fact, it's the second derivative, as we would expect. Now, integrating this over the surface gives you the Euler characteristic, which is 2 minus 2g for a Riemann surface. You can easily check this for some simple examples using the classical Gauss-Bonnier theorem. So this is the final statement. Riemann-Roch tells you something about solutions of potentially complicated differential equations, given in terms of topology of the surface you're working on, now in complex analysis. What's it good for? Well, it's good for many things. The Riemann-Hurwitz theorem follows from Riemann-Roch. Riemann-Hurwitz relates the Euler characteristic of a surface that covers another surface. And this will bring us back to that square root we were talking about. Ramification is an important concept that captures that locally, conformal transformation can be a power like this. And that could mean that some points, if you have some fibers over some space, at some points, the ramified points, these fibers could coincide. For example, here all three coincide, here two of them coincide, and so on. So here's my concrete example. Z is square root of W. If you go through this very simply, you see that actually square root of 1 is plus 1 up here, and square root of 1 is minus 1 down here, in the explicit sense I'm talking about here. So this is a non-compact Riemann surface. So this is a slight generalization of what I was talking about before, but this really helps understanding what it means to take square root, to have branch cuts, and to have logarithms, complex logarithms, and so on. Now, what you want to do is talk about functions on these spaces, and on genus 2 and higher, these are Siegel modular forms. They are to elliptic modular forms that you might have heard of, what abelian varieties are to elliptic curves. This is the Norwegian mathematician Abel. And this is a nice paper. So the claim is that Martin Raum will eventually write a new book on this that we're all very much looking forward to. Riemann surfaces are very important in algebraic geometry, because a complex curve is a one complex dimensional like a Riemann surface. And in fact, any genus 1 Riemann surface can be written as a cubic curve. So this simple expression by the Weierstrass P function. So if you're interested in this kind of stuff, there's a lot to read about this. Let me mention one generalization. As I tried to say earlier, Riemann-Roch is an index theorem. Here's a more modern index theorem from the 60s, T.S. Singer. I won't describe the details too much, but there's some beautiful lectures on that here by Jeff Harvey. And I can't resist mentioning that I coordinated a conference a long time ago at Cornell where we had this beautiful picture drawn by David Marsh of the cosmic microwave background wrapped on a genus 2 surface. Why are surfaces interesting in physics? Well, at least in string theory, they're obviously interesting because the world sheet, the surface spanned out by the string as it moves in time, in these simple cases, are Riemann surfaces weighted by the string coupling. And it gives you string amplitude, which in the Lorentzian limit gives you Feynman diagrams in quantum field theory. Even if you're not too interested in string theory per se, they're an efficient way to calculate Feynman diagrams in quantum field theory and in particle physics and in condensed matter physics and so on.